All right, so...
So I've captured you.
Yeah, yeah. Ditto.
Yes, yeah. And we've escaped to Hollywood, where we're playing all this amazing music.
Yeah.
Very different music. What's it like to conduct this kind of music?
Well, the quick answer is it's sensational. It feels like a slightly sort of forbidden thing because, of course, we spend a lot of our lives spending a lot of time thinking very deeply as sort of analysis and very subtle construction of works that have big forms, you know, symphonic works. And my feeling this week with these shorter works is of being able to luxuriate the sound, enjoying the instrument of the orchestra, hearing it in all its sonority and all its beauty in loud passages, but also then the subtlety of sound you can get when you have 50 strings playing piano. I've also realized once again just the level of craftsmanship and quality that went into that music in Hollywood and still does to this day. You know, they're great composers, these people.
Have you seen the films like Ben-Hur? I mean,
yeah.
And do you, I mean, what's it like? What's the difference when you actually are there making the music? You know the images, you've seen the images, you know how impressive they are.
Yeah.
But when you take away the images and you've just got this music, what's that like?
Well, I think The thing that's so evocative about this music is that it does capture what they were trying to describe, or, you know, the images, the scenes that they were trying to accompany. And yet, at the same time, if you try and forget the film and just view it in the abstract, it's evocative music. It could be anything you want it to be, but it goes straight in here. It doesn't go through the intellect at any point, a lot of it. It just hits you straight in the stomach and the heart.
That these composers who arrived in the States, I mean, if you think of somebody like Korngold, you know, who'd come out of that incredible sort of fin de siècle with being worshipped by everybody from Richard Strauss, you know, through to that whole dynasty, arriving at the request of Max Reinhardt to come and orchestrate Midsummer Night's Dream. I mean, it's also quite something.
Yeah.
What do you think he must have felt like? I mean, in terms of, you know, the musical possibilities at that time.
What is so wonderful to see with Korngold is that this language that we think of as Hollywood is his language. He wasn't changing himself to suit Hollywood. He was saying, right, I'm going to be myself because I believe that the what I have to say in my music is also suitable for this this genre. And which is why we associate so much the sound that you hear in Korngold with what we associate with the Hollywood of that time.
Some people, you know, like to criticize film music. They say maybe it's, you know, not the same kind of level. What would you say to that?
Well, a bit like with books that sell a lot and people don't like, you know, I say, well, go out and write it. And then if you can just strip it off like that, then you can criticize it. No, the skill set required to put together great symphonic film music is huge. It is huge. To look at a film, I mean, it's sometimes useful to try and imagine this. If you're watching a film, just to put it on mute and to imagine you've never seen any of these scenes before. That's what happens to a composer. He gets given a film which has the audio and it has people moving around, you know, you can hear the text, but he has to change that world with the music, support that world and deepen that world. And it's only when you turn off the music you realize how much effect it has. I mean, the typical example is a Hitchcock film.
We've worked together a few times over the last few years, but I kind of feel I've known you all my life because we go back to similar places. We both grew up in Highgate in London. Our parents know each other, so it's kind of, it's a curious,
it's true.
Very nice
sort
of connection there.
Yeah, we saw each other last in Berlin a week or two ago, and my wife was there with me, and it was funny. We were saying, I was saying to her, as much as one doesn't want to believe it, background does actually give people a lot of similarities. You know, being brought up in Highgate, this part of London where we were both brought up, I think one sort of ticks in a similar way.
Yeah,
so
it's true.
Yeah, it's interesting.
It's true.
And I think that also, I mean, I feel musically, I kind of get what you're wanting to do pretty quickly.
Somebody else who spent a lot of time in Highgate was Sting.
Yeah.
And you know, he's on this album. I wanted to have this piece, this beautiful song of Hanns Eisler, because Hanns Eisler for me is one of those ultimate sort of, you know, exile composers. And it was just coincidence that Sting had done this version. But how do you feel about his music and his way of?
Sting is one of those people that's kind of the background. He's the ether of all life, you know? It's like Michael Jackson. He's just one of those people everybody in the world knows. Over the course of I don't know how many years, he's produced so many great albums and songs and so many different constellations as well. With the Police, also then the jazzier stuff, you know, and the smaller ensemble, everything. And he's just an interesting and you know, cultivated musician. And the song is exceptionally good.
It is.
Because it is so unusual. The uneven measures, the uneven sort of periods within the phrases, the stop in the middle, just an empty bar or two, and then the second verse starting. It's a very special song, it's a little gem.
And we've got Max Raabe on the other side who, you know, represents that world probably like nobody else can, with that voice, with the whole persona.
The suit, the hair.
But I wanted to have that also on the album. Yeah. So, you know, it takes you back to where you are in a sense.
No, I found that choice of repertoire, the choice of artists as well, not only musically fantastic, it's just going to be great to listen to, but it also makes a very good point that still to this day, that music is inspiring artists who are very current, who are very important, and who recognize in what was written back then, the beauty of it and the craftsmanship and the sort of eternal quality of a lot of those stuff.
Darling, speak low. Love is a spark lost in the dark. Too soon, I feel.